Good morning. Our world belongs to God, not to us or to earthly powers, not to demons, not to fate, not to chance. The earth is the Lord's. In our work, we hear the call to serve others, and in our serving them, we serve our Lord, who said, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Let us worship God. Welcome to this time of worship on the Lord's Day. It is always good to be with you as we worship God together. Please take time to sign the friendship pad and share it with one another and greet each other in the name of Jesus Christ. It's a very special day in the life of our church as we receive Tammy Callahan as a member of this church and a member of this community of faith. Please notice all the different things. We've got several inserts in the bulletin today with information that you will want to know about. On one of the inserts is a plan for preaching, worship leadership, and pastoral care. I'm going to have knee surgery on Tuesday at Cape Fear Hospital in Wilmington, and I'm going to be out for a while. I don't know how long, but I'll be back. And we've got some wonderful people lined up to preach, and I encourage you to come and worship God and to be here. Next week is Spencer Parks, Gene Parks' son, and then on the 8th is Music Sunday. On the 15th, Matt Highfill, and then on the 22nd, either Jim Sills or I will be in the pulpit. We'll just have to wait and see. I'll miss being with you, but I'm going to watch you on TV, so sing loud. Loudly. We have 3 minutes for mission today. The first, Ann Carter, about a trip to Mike's farm, and then Susie Bullard about South Carolina flood relief, and then Madeline Coombs about Operation Christmas Child.
This year we have reservations. Last year we missed it, but this year the reservations were made on August the 1st for our Mike's Farm trip, which will be on December the 8th, Tuesday night. We will have dinner, which is family style, all you can eat, fried chicken, biscuits and honey, all the extras that go with that. And then we will go on the tractor drive through the woods, which we'll have the nativity scene. It will snow on us. We urge all of you to go, and you can get your tickets from Bill Walters, Jerry Hansen, Brenda Long, Dottie Obenauer, Lois Edgerton, or me. And the tickets are $26, which includes your meal, gratuity, and the tractor ride. See you all there.
Good morning. Good morning. As you know, South Carolina is dealing with some major flooding issues. I don't know if a lot of you know, but I'm originally from South Carolina. I'm from Georgetown, which is between Myrtle Beach and Charleston. And a lot of the flooding that occurred in Columbia has headed down toward the coast. There's a lot of towns between Georgetown and Columbia that have been flooded. Places like Kingstree and Andrews. Kingstree, the town of Kingstree, was flooded. When you go through Andrews, if you took a boat through there, you are seeing two-story houses underwater. You have to duck for the power lines. Not too long ago, during the flooding, ABC News had a news. One of their broadcasts was from the top of a house on the Black River. That was one of my brother's best friend's house that they actually showed. So these people are now, the waters have receded, and they're having to deal with the cleanup. And they've lost everything. Well, our Presbyterian Disaster Assistance is putting together cleanup buckets. We have one down here with the blue buckets. They have been handing these out to the flood victims, and we are trying to help them replenish their warehouse because they have given out just about everything that's in their warehouse. And these are called the Gift of the Heart Cleanup Buckets. These buckets are extremely helpful as the first step in the recovery process as families return to their homes and see the urgent need to clean the mud and debris left by the flood waters. The kids have the basic supplies needed to begin the process. In your bulletin, there's a list of supplies that are needed. We're asking those that are interested to donate any of the items on the list. If you would like to put an entire cleanup bucket together, that would be great. The youth will be helping to pack these cleanup buckets. So anything that you have, if you can just get the sponges or whatever. Garrett and I actually put this bucket together, and it says $56 on this. We were able to put the bucket together for less than $40. Dollar Tree had just about everything that went into it. So between the Dollar Tree and the Dollar General, we already had the bucket, but Walmart has the buckets. But you know, if you're willing to put, just give anything to put in it, that would be great. We would like to receive everything by Sunday, November 8th. During the service that day, we'll request anyone that has supplies to bring them to the communion table, and then we'll have a blessing. We appreciate any support that you can offer for this. Thank you.
And this is the bucket. Everything's in it, fits right in.
Once again, our church family will have the opportunity to bring some joy into the lives of needy children through one of the Samaritan Purse programs, Operation Christmas Child. Your outreach ministry team would like to ask you to prepare a shoebox and donate it to this cause. Flyers like this are located on a table in the fellowship hall. In the flyer, you will find step-by-step instructions on how to pack your shoebox. Packed shoeboxes may be placed on the table in the fellowship hall any time between now and November 15th. At that time, the boxes will be shipped to Samaritan's Purse in Boone, in North Carolina. You may remember last November, some of our middle school Logos children and several adults went to Boone to experience the Operation Christmas Child firsthand by helping with the assembly line process of preparing the shoeboxes for shipping to the children. Franklin Graham, the president of Samaritan's Purse, says Operation Christmas Child partners with churches worldwide to reach boys and girls with the gospel of Jesus Christ. After receiving shoebox gifts, many children are discipled through Bible study courses where they learn to become faithful followers of Christ and share their faith with others. Please donate a shoebox gift to this worthwhile project.
Our call to worship this morning is on page 582 in the hymnal if you would like to join us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Let us read responsively our opening sentences. With hearts filled with gratitude, we worship God this day. With minds eager to grow in understanding, We worship God this day. With lives open to love, we worship God this day. Let us give thanks to God and bless His holy name. Our opening hymn is hymn number 1, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty.
Many times our best efforts fail, and many times we don't even put forth our best efforts. But God's abundant grace is strong and eternal, and God's forgiveness is ours through Jesus Christ. Friends, let us offer our confession of sin to God, confident in His grace and love through our Lord Jesus Christ. Join me in our unison prayer of confession and our responsive assurance of pardon. Let us pray. God of goodness and power, faithful and sure, in You we live and move and have our being, and are moved to worship You in beauty, in truth, and in holiness. You are the fountain of life. You refresh us. You are the light of the world. You show us the way. You are the living Spirit. You heal us. And so we join our voices with the saints and disciples of every time and place in worshiping You as Creator, as Healer, and as the source of all joy and goodness, now and forever, world without end. Eternal God, we confess that we have been indifferent to Your will and silent when we should have spoken for justice. We have heard Your call to faithful living, but fear holds us back. There is work to be done, but we have been idle or only served grudgingly. Forgive us, O God, and give us courage that we may be Your saints in our own time, by your grace in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Once we were slaves to sin, living lives that led only to death. But thanks be to God. In his mercy, God has set us free from the power of sin and death and has offered us eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. Now we are free to choose life and to use our lives to bring honor and glory to God. Thanks be to God. Let us sing God's praises for his mercy in our lives. It's a great joy as we welcome Tammy Callahan as a member of this congregation. At this time, I'd like to invite her to join me in front of the steps and also Elder George Francis, who will be representing the session.
On behalf of the session, it's my privilege to present Tammy Wren Callahan, who has been received into membership of this congregation by reaffirmation of faith.
Tammy met with the session on Tuesday night, shared her desire to unite with this congregation. She's been a part of this community of faith for a good while, and we're glad to have her. She comes to us by reaffirmation of faith, so as a part of that, I'll be asking her some questions. Tammy, you come to us as a member of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church into which you were baptized and by which you have been nurtured in your faith. And we are one with each other, sisters and brothers in the faith and in the family of God. We rejoice in the gifts that you bring to us. And as you join us in the worship and service of this congregation, it's fitting that all of us reaffirm the covenant into which we have been baptized and that we claim again the promises of God, which are ours in baptism. Listen to these words from the scriptures. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father, who is in all and above all and through all. As many of you as were baptized into Jesus Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ, there is no longer Jew or Greek, there is no longer slave or free, there is no longer male or female, for all of you are one in Christ Jesus. Tammy, our baptism is the sign and seal of our cleansing from sin and of our being grafted into Christ. Through the birth, life, death, and resurrection of Christ, the power of sin was broken and God's kingdom entered our world. Through our baptism, we were made citizens of God's kingdom and freed from the bondage of sin. And so we celebrate that freedom and redemption through the renewal of the promises made at our baptism. And I ask you, therefore, once again, to reject sin and to profess your faith in Christ Jesus and to confess the faith of the church in which we were baptized. So, Tammy, I ask you to reaffirm your faith by answering four questions. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? Do you?
I do.
Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior? Do you? Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love to your life's end? Will you?
I will.
And finally, will you be a faithful member of this congregation, sharing its worship and ministry through your prayers and gifts, your study and service, and so fulfill your calling to be a disciple of Jesus Christ? Will you?
I will.
I invite all of you, if you're able, to stand at this time and let us reaffirm our faith as we use the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Let us pray. Holy God, we praise you for calling us to be a servant people and for gathering us into the body of Christ. We thank you for choosing to add to our number Tammy Wren Callahan. We pray, O Lord, that you would defend your servant Tammy with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more until she comes to your everlasting kingdom. Together may we all live in your Spirit and so love one another that we may have the mind of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom we give honor and glory forever. Amen. Tammy, welcome to the life and ministry of this congregation. The peace of Christ be with you.
Thank you.
I commend Tammy to you. If you don't know her, you need to get to know her. What a delight. And we're glad you're a part of this family. God bless you. On the fourth Sunday of the month, we take up the Feed Our Hungry Children backpack offering. And we've got some young people back there ready to do that. And the buckets are up here at the front. I guess y'all figured that out. So we appreciate your support of this offering. Children to join me on the steps for the children's sermon. Hey Eli, how are you? Jesse. Hey JJ. We got a lot of things up here today. Some of what we've had before. We had the buckets up here, we've had the offering plate up here. And this is different. This basket, I had a bag of food before, but if you look in that basket, you see some food, some cans of food, some other things. And Miss Susie's already talked to us about this 5-gallon bucket. You want to look in here, see what's in there? all sorts of cleaning supplies and masks and bags and sponges and some rope, all sorts of things. And then this box is empty, but it could be filled up. It's one of the shoe boxes that gets sent around the world. Now, some people might have come in this morning and said, wow, look at all those things up there. And people got asked to do a lot of things today. I know that. But we don't always know when somebody's going to get flooded out. Doesn't happen when we want it to. Not that we ever want it to, but we can't plan for those things. Or when somebody gets hungry, or somebody in the family loses their job and they don't have enough money to go to the grocery store anymore. Or people around the world, boys and girls around the world that don't have things that we have that we enjoy. Or even people right here in our schools in Duplin County that don't always have enough to eat. So that's why we ask people to make offerings for these things. Either putting money in an offering plate or a bucket, or going out like Miss Susan Garrett did and going to Dollar General, Dollar Tree, and filling up a bucket like that. Because at some point, somebody we don't even know is going to get this bucket, and they're going to use everything in that bucket to clean up their house. Or maybe they're going to clean up a neighbor's house. Maybe their house was fine, but they're going to clean up. Can you imagine if this room was almost completely full of water? Can you imagine that? It would destroy everything in here, wouldn't it? But some people's houses were under that much water down in South Carolina, and they don't have anything left. And so people all across the United States are helping them by sending these kinds of things and sending money. And boys and girls in other countries are getting Christmas gifts. Can you imagine if you'd never gotten any kind of present before, getting a box and opening it, and that it's full of nice things and things that you'd never even imagined that you would have, how much fun that would be to get that, how much that would help you. So we do ask people, we give people opportunities to do things, because unfortunately in the world, there are always things that need to be done. There are always people that need our help. And God has given us so much. And he says, part of the reason he gives us so much, the Bible says, is so we can use it to help people that don't have quite as much. Or people who lose everything they have when the floodwaters come or a tornado comes or something like that. So thank you all for helping out with these things. And thank everybody for making contributions when there's a need. Let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you that you bless us. We know that we go through hard times sometimes, but we are blessed by other people that help us. And we thank you for giving us the opportunities to use the things that you've blessed us with to help people who are really struggling. Help us to know that things like sponges and masks can bring hope to people, and most of all, let them know that somebody somewhere cares about them. And we do all this because we know that you love us and you ask us to love each other. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for coming up.
sin, my cross, my shame. Rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy.
As we get ready to hear God's word, it's printed in the bulletin. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you said, "Blessed are those who hear the word of God and obey it." May we hear your word today and obey it, that we may put our trust in your unfailing promises. Amen.
Our gospel lesson this morning is taken from Matthew. I'll be reading from chapter 6, verses 19 through 21. You can follow along in your pew Bibles on page 787. These are Jesus' words in the Sermon on the Mount, teaching about money and treasures. "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consumes, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Our next hymn is number 697, "Take My Life."
Thank you.
I invite you to listen for some words from the Apostle Paul. It's a pretty lengthy reading. I'm convinced, I don't know this for 100%, but I'm convinced that when Paul wrote his letters, he did not sit down and think, oh, I'm writing the Holy Scriptures. He's writing a letter to some people that he knew and loved and did not always have the best relationship with in the Corinthian church. But he had helped found that church. He had lived among them for 18 months. He had worked with them, and now he is no longer with them. And these verses that we're hearing from the 8th and 9th chapters of 2 Corinthians are about an offering that Paul had encouraged them to participate in, not just from those churches, but a number of churches. And this is his encouragement to them about that. So I invite you to listen for the Word of God. We want you to know, brothers and sisters, about the grace of God that has been granted to the churches of Macedonia. For during a severe ordeal of affliction, their abundant joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. For as I can testify, they voluntarily gave according to their means and even beyond their means, begging us earnestly for the privilege of sharing in this ministry to the saints, and this not merely as we expected. They gave themselves first to the Lord and by the will of God to us, so that we might urge Titus that as he had already made a beginning, so he should also complete this generous undertaking among you. Now, as you excel in everything, in faith and speech and knowledge and utmost eagerness and in our love for you, so we want you to excel also in this generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I am testing the genuineness of your love against the earnestness of others. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. And in this matter I am giving my advice. It is appropriate for you who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something. Now finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it according to your means. For if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of a fair balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need, in order that there may be a fair balance. As it is written, the one who had much did not have too much, the one who had little did not have too little. But thanks be to God, who put in the heart of Titus the same eagerness for you that I myself have. For he not only accepted our appeal, but since he is more eager than ever, he is going to you of his own accord. With him we are sending the brother who is famous among all the churches for his proclaiming the good news. And not only that, but he has also been appointed by the churches to travel with us while we are administering this generous undertaking for the glory of the Lord himself and to show our goodwill. We intend that no one should blame us about this generous gift that we are administering, for we intend to do what is right, not only in the Lord's sight, but also in the sight of others. And with them we are sending our brother whom we have often tested and found eager in many matters, but who is now more eager than ever because of his great confidence in you. As for Titus, he is my partner and co-worker in your service. As for our brothers, they are messengers of the churches, the glory of Christ. Therefore, openly before the churches, show them the proof of your love and of our reason for boasting about you. Now, it is not necessary for me to write about the ministry to the saints, for I know your eagerness, which is the subject of my boasting about you to the people of Macedonia, saying that Achaia had been ready since last year, and your zeal has stirred up most of them. But I am sending the brothers in order that our boasting about you may not prove to have been empty in this case, so that you may be ready as I said you would be. Otherwise, if some Macedonians come with me and find that you are not ready, we would be humiliated, to say nothing of you, in this undertaking. So I thought it necessary to urge the brothers to go on ahead to you and arrange in advance for this bountiful gift that you have promised, so that it may be ready as a voluntary gift and not as an extortion. The point is this: the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. As it is written, he scatters abroad, he gives to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your great generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us. For the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. Through the testing of this ministry, you glorify God by your obedience to the confession of the gospel of Christ and by the generosity of your sharing with them and with all others, while they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God that he has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. May God bless the reading and our hearing of his holy word. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Two men were stranded on a small deserted island in the middle of the vast ocean. They had nothing but the clothes on their back and one palm tree to sit under. One man was in an absolute panic. "We're going to die," he said. "They'll never find us out here. We're going to die." The other man was casually lying under the palm tree, relaxing in the shade. "We have nothing to worry about," he said. "Calm down. They'll find us and it won't take very long." "Are you crazy?" shouted the first man. "We're on a desert island in the middle of the ocean. How in the world can you be so calm? We're going to die." Once again, the other man very calmly said, "We're going to be fine. Calm down. They're going to find us. Don't worry." The first man was beside him and said, "How can you say that? What makes you so sure they're going to find us?" "Look," said the man under the palm tree, "I make $100,000 a week, and I give 10% each week to my church. My preacher is going to find us." Three preachers were talking one day about how they decided how much of the Sunday offering to keep for themselves. The first minister said, "Well, after worship, I take all the money into the sanctuary. I draw a big circle on the carpet, and I throw all the money in the air. And whatever lands outside the circle goes to God. Whatever lands inside the circle, I keep." Second preacher said, "I do something very similar. I also draw a big circle on the carpet and throw money in the air. However, what lands inside the circle goes to God, and what lands outside the circle, I keep." The third preacher said, "Well, I draw a circle on the carpet, and I throw all the money in the air, and whatever stays up in the air goes to God, and whatever lands on the carpet, I keep." On the way to church one Sunday morning, six-year-old Johnny's mother gave him a quarter. "Now, Johnny," she said, "when it's time for the offering, put the quarter in the offering plate." Johnny held the quarter tight all through the service. When it came time for the offering and the offering plate came down the pew, Johnny's mother whispered to him, "Okay, Johnny, put the money in the plate." Johnny shook his head no and held on to the quarter. Johnny's father leaned over and said, "Johnny, put the quarter in the offering plate." Johnny shook his head and held on to the quarter. And they didn't want to cause a scene, so his parents just gave up. After the service, as Johnny and his parents were shaking hands with the minister, Johnny gave the minister the quarter and said, "Here, this is for you." And the minister said, "Now, Johnny, you really should have put that in the offering plate." And Johnny said, "Well, that's what my mama and daddy said. And I was going to, but on the way to church, I heard my dad say you were the poorest preacher we've ever had. And I thought you might need it." Okay, I've gotten that out of the way. And I've got a million jokes about preachers and money, and they're all at the expense of the preacher, and I just want to let you know I've heard most of them. And I wanted to get that off the table. So now let's hear what the Apostle Paul has to say about being good stewards of God's grace. When we moved to Wallace in March 1998, folks here told me about how our church had responded to some devastating floods in the Midwest. They had organized a relief effort for people they did not even know, but the people were in dire need, and this church responded generously and quickly, and it made a difference. 18 months after I moved here and heard that story, Hurricanes Dennis and Floyd inundated our area with torrential rains and massive flooding. Almost overnight, our fellowship hall became a relief center, and to be quite honest with you, I lost count how many times we filled that room up and emptied it in the next couple of months with various relief items. Within a couple of days of the flooding, I began to receive some cash contributions from church members and some from other people to help with relief efforts. And it quickly became evident to me that that aspect of the relief effort was something I didn't really need to do, and I didn't really want to handle it. I had other things to take care of. One day, a large group of people from this church was working in the fellowship hall, sorting and packing food, making food bags to distribute. And I talked with Toots Carlton, and I asked Toots if he would be willing to oversee the receipt and disbursement of financial contributions. Before he agreed to the job, Toots asked me, "How much money are you talking about?" I had no idea, and I said, "Toots, I don't know, maybe $40,000 to $50,000. Well, he agreed to take the job, and with the help of his daughters, Linda and Emily, and a group appointed by the session to make decisions about how to distribute the relief money, he handled that part of our church's relief effort. And when it was all said and done, and we balanced the books, we had received and distributed almost $285,000 from across the United States. 2.5 years later, I was sitting at my desk when my study was still in the fellowship hall, and my phone rang, and it was a friend from somewhere else calling about something. And he said, "Hey, what are you doing?" And I said, "Well, I just literally wrote the last check for flood relief." And he said, "What flood?" I said, "Hurricane Floyd." He said, "That was 2.5 years ago. I'd forgotten all about that." And I said, "Well, people around here haven't forgotten about it." And one of the most memorable experiences in that relief effort for many people, I believe, was when three people from the farm country of Indiana arrived in time for one of our Thursday Advent services in December. Now, Floyd hit in September. They had driven nonstop all the way from Indiana to Wallace to hand deliver a check from their church. They worshiped with us, they ate lunch with us, then they got in their car and drove back to Indiana. In February, they returned to help rebuild a house in Chinkapin. And when we asked them why they had come all the way from Indiana to help us, they said they had heard in church about the flooding and the needs here in Wallace, and they wanted to help. It was remarkable. In August 2005, Hurricane Katrina slammed into the Mississippi Gulf Coast and New Orleans. Our session asked me to help find a way to help some individuals in their recovery. So I talked to my brother David, my big brother, who's lived and worked in New Orleans since he went to college in 1968. And he's the CEO of a company that was flooded out, and most of the people lost what they had, and they all got evacuated to other towns. David told me about two valued employees in their company who had lost everything in their flooding, a woman named Mary and a woman named Tawana. Our church responded generously and overwhelmingly. And it was not just in the immediate aftermath of the flood, but for a couple of years afterwards. We sent many boxes of Christmas gifts and many boxes of birthday gifts, along with financial support. Some of you who were here then will remember that we sent a final check to Mary Granger and Tawana Washington as we were closing out all the accounts. We sent Mary Granger a check for $7,000. My brother told me at the time that when he called Mary into his office and gave her the check, she broke down and cried because she had found a new house for her and her daughter, and she had all the money she needed except $7,000. And she had no idea where it was going to come from, and that check allowed her to buy another house for herself and her daughter. I talked to my brother the other day on the phone because I was asking him about how they were doing, and he said, oh, Mary and Tawana, he said, they're still working for us. He said, they're great employees. And he said that Mary's daughter, who had a hearing deficiency, received a cochlear implant and is thriving in school. And Tawana's son received a scholarship from Louisiana, is in attending LSU. And that Tawana, who worked in the gift wrap department, is now the manager of the gift wrap department. And they put together and wrap 10,000 gift baskets a year. And he said, thank you, because it has made a difference for those people in their lives. I know Carla and Wayne got to meet Mary in New Orleans, and somebody else got to meet Mary. And she walked from behind the deli counter where she worked, and the manager said, you need to get back to work. And she said, I'm going to talk to these folks, and then I'll get back to work, because she wanted to see the folks from Wallace. I got to meet them, meet her and Tawana.
So real life stories about things that happened. The Apostle Paul wrote to the Christians at Corinth about their benevolent giving. And he said, I don't mean that they should give relief to other people and then put pressure on yourself, but he said it's a question of a fair balance between your abundant need and their, or your abundance and their present need, because someday it'll flip-flop and their abundance will be there for your need.
Paul was determined to make good on his promise to take an offering of money to some Jewish Christians in the mother church in Jerusalem. They were experiencing hard economic times. And Paul started a financial campaign in the Gentile churches over in Asia Minor, Macedonia and Achaia, sort of where modern-day Turkey and Greece, that area. He had established many of these churches. He had served as their pastor, and he knew these people. He knew the Gentile Christians. He had lived and worked with them. He also knew the Jewish Christians in Jerusalem. And in another one of his letters, this one to the Galatians, Paul tells about an earlier visit to Jerusalem when he met with the pillars of the church, Peter, James, and John. And he said, I laid out my missionary experiences. I told them what I'd been doing, how I'd been preaching the gospel to the Gentiles over in the West. And he writes, they gave to Barnabas and me the right hand of fellowship, agreeing that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the circumcised. And they asked only one thing, that we remember the poor. And Paul says, which was what I was eager to do anyway. Paul knew that the Jewish Christians in Jerusalem desperately needed the financial help that other churches could provide. Paul was also determined to collect this offering from the Gentile churches because he knew it would be an important and powerful symbol of the unity between the Jewish and Gentile Christians. In so many words, Paul reminded the Gentile Christians that they had benefited from the Jewish Christians proclaiming the gospel of salvation to them. And now, when the opportunity came for the Gentiles to do something to benefit the Jewish Christians, material blessings, money, to help them in their time of need, Paul encouraged them strongly to make good on their promise to help. He knew and hoped that the monetary offering went far beyond the dollars and cents that he would take back to Jerusalem. He knew it could make a difference in the church. Last Sunday, I shared some thoughts about what stewardship is not and what stewardship is. And this week, I'd like to share some principles of being good stewards of God's grace. And these come straight from 2 Corinthians 8 and 9, straight from the pen of the Apostle Paul. He says, they gave themselves first to the Lord and by the will of God to us. He writes, for if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. Paul writes, each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And that last phrase gets pulled out of context so much and just tossed around. But listen to what Paul is saying in all of this. Paul says, God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance. Why? So that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. He says, the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. These stewardship principles apply to our regular giving in the church, as well as our response to emergency situations. This was not planned today, our minutes for mission. Well, I mean, they were, but it wasn't orchestrated to fit with this sermon. To hear about Operation Christmas Child, to hear about South Carolina relief kits. It's the fourth Sunday and we take up this offering. These principles that Paul lays out apply to our use of our time, our spiritual gifts, as well as our money and our other material resources. And these principles remind us that our stewardship is first and foremost rooted in the grace of God and God's gift in Jesus Christ. So once again, we have an opportunity to share from our abundance with saints who are in need. And we've heard different opportunities today. Susie has shared with us about the devastating floods in her hometown of Georgetown, South Carolina, and in her home state of South Carolina. And as Yogi Berra would say, it's deja vu all over again. And once again, there is a personal connection between the folks in need and someone in our congregation. But it's true that there will always be opportunities for us to help, and there will always come times when we need help. And as you consider how you will use what God has given you, your money, your possessions, your time, your spiritual gifts, remember that we are all called to be good stewards of God's grace, and that the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. The most important and most basic stewardship principle of all is this: thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. This prayer that I want to offer, which is very brief, I remember Joe Morrison, former pastor of this church, my predecessor. He served here from 1966 to 1973 and then retired here in Wallace. So I was at many gatherings with Joe, and he would get called on to say a blessing. And he used this short prayer, which is a paraphrase of the first lines of George Herbert's poem and prayer called Gratefulness. So let us pray. Lord, you have given so much to us. Give us one thing more, a grateful heart. Amen. Today, as we pray, we rejoice and celebrate with the Castine family. Congratulations to Zach and Andrea on the birth of their daughter, Clara Gray, on Friday afternoon at 3:51 p.m., 6 pounds, 14 ounces, 17 and a half inches. Adeline Jo is a big sister. And congratulations to Wayne and Carla on being grandparents again. Are they coming home today? Good. Very good. Some prayer requests. I'd like to ask you to pray for Cheryl Siddons. She and her husband Larry have attended our church some. Cheryl's fighting cancer. She's been in the hospital this week. I went to visit them this week, and she very much needs our prayers. And our church is going to keep Cape Fear Hospital in business this week. I'm having knee replacement surgery on Tuesday, and Pat Wilson's having knee replacement surgery on Wednesday. So I'm going to ask the PT folks if I can walk down to Pat's room and pay a visit to her, see if they'll let me do that. But I would appreciate your prayers. Thank you for all the prayers that have come my way. And also ask you to pray for Pat and Worth as they go into this together. Let us pray together. Good and gracious God, we thank you for all the wonderful blessings of our lives. We thank you that when our church and families in our church have gone through hard times, people we don't even know have responded so generously and in very particular ways. And we thank you for the opportunity to respond in kind. We are sorry that we have to help people who are going through hard times because of the devastation they're suffering. But we thank you that you give us an abundance of which to share. And we do all of this to try to be good followers of Jesus, who said, love one another and do this unto the least among my family. And we do it because you blessed us with the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who gave us everything that we might have life in you. We thank you, Lord. Lord, we rejoice and celebrate with Zach and Andrea, and we welcome Clara Gray. We thank you that she is doing well and that Andrea is doing well. We ask your blessings on them as they come home and on this family. And we thank you for this beautiful little girl in our church family. Lord, we thank you for bringing Tammy into our church family. We pray that she will be blessed and that we will be nurtured and strengthened in our relationship together. Lord, I do pray for Cheryl and Larry Siddons. Pray for Cheryl in this difficult time as she battles this cancer. Ask you for strength of her body and for her spirit. And Lord, I thank you for the prayers, and I pray for Dr. O'Malley on Tuesday, and I pray for Pat's surgeon on Wednesday as we go through these operations, and pray that they will make a difference ask you to be with Nancy and with Worth in the weeks to come. We thank you for your goodness to us and your healing powers, and we thank you that people have the knowledge and skill to help others. Lord, I thank you for this church, for the generosity of this church over the years, the willingness to be involved, the willingness to reach out in a very personal way to other people in places far away and even nearby. Lord, continue to bless us so that we might bless others, not for our own glory, not for our own enjoyment, but in the service of your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask these things in his name as we pray together his prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's continue our worship as we present our tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Oh God, we dedicate our gifts to you. Help us to use them to glorify you. Help us to be vessels of your work in this world. Oh God, use us to do your work in this world. Help us to see we are all ministers called into the body of Christ. Use us in your service. We pray over these tithes and offerings, blessing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 697, the final three verses.
Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Amen.